Hi, everybody. Are we ready to get started? I'll assume that's a yes. So my name is Lisa Jo Elliott. Dr. Elliott, my students call me. I'm an engineering psychologist. I'm one of 10 psychologists who teach here on the faculty at Behrend. I happen to be the only engineering psychologist. We have a clinical psychologist and then many different types of experimental psychologists. My type of psychologist, engineering psychologist, is considered an experimental psychologist. And so what I do is I examine technology and try and make it easier for people to use. Here at Behrend, we offer two courses in experimental psychology, or I'm sorry, in engineering psychology, and we also offer a certificate that helps people start their career in engineering psychology. Most students will go on to get a master's and then go work in a tech organization or really any organization. They might work at Rivian. I have a couple of students there. They might work at PlayStation. I have a couple of former students that work there as well. I used to work at IBM, and all of us are working to make technology a little bit more useful and easier for us all to use. And I know many of you have struggled with technology this semester. You're not alone. And so my colleagues and I across the globe are all working hard to make it a little bit easier on all of us. But today I want to talk about robots and psychology. And I also want to remind everybody that I'm recording the session today, and you won't be part of the session, but I will be part of the session. So your names and everything will be edited out, and no one will know that you were here. I will be, the university might be able to use this in the future as well. So let me share my screen. Let's see. So today I want to talk about psychology robots. It's a topic that you may not have thought a lot about. You may not have thought that robotics and AI really got its start in psychological research. So we're gonna talk a little bit about that today. And go ahead and stop me anytime during the presentation if you have questions. Let's see. So psychology started a long time ago. Hopefully many of you have taken Intro to Psych in high school, and you learn about Skinner and all sorts of people, James and all the forefathers of psychology. But as psychology has grown through the decades, our theory has become quantifiable. And what that means is we've been able to put numbers to things within psychology. So we've been able to say, if you have so much of this, then if this happens, you will get so much of that. So we're becoming a little closer to some of the other natural sciences. Although in psychology it's very difficult because there's so much variability in humans. And so once psychology theory became quantifiable around the 70s or 80s, and I'll go into more detail in a minute, then we were able to partner with our friends in computer science and philosophy and math. At the same time, robotics technology started to expand, and it started to become much more advanced. And these two things started to combine, and people started to get degrees both in computer science and in psychology. And so some of the beginnings of this idea that psychology could be quantifiable really started back with Phineas Gage, and you'll remember him from Intro to Psych. And poor Phineas, you know, is the guy that had the pole that went through his brain. He was a railroad worker. Pardon me. I have allergies, so I apologize. And this pole, this metal post, was removed. And then after it was removed, his personality changed dramatically. And that was really our first example of how the mind is modular. So there are different parts of the brain that are specialized at different things. And now this idea that you only use 10% of your brain, pardon me, is baloney. We really use all of our brain all the time. But there are parts of our brain that are more specialized to do certain things. And in Phineas's case, when that pole went through the very front of his head, that disrupted the executive pole, and it disrupted his ability to make decisions and his personality in a great respect. And so psychology theory continued, experimentalism continued. B.F. Skinner did his work, and B.F. Skinner was a big fan of behaviorism. His perspective was that people acted in response to reward and punishment, and the different combinations of reward and punishment would predict different types of behavior in people. And that's very true. But Noam Chomsky came on the scene, and you may have heard of him. He's very active in politics right now. But originally, he was interested in language. And originally, he was, and he still is, an experimental psychologist. And so he had a discussion with B.F. Skinner. Actually, it was a very spirited discussion during a conference. And he exclaimed that human behavior has to be more than just behavior. There is a lot of evidence in language that our behavior is generative. That means that we generate it on the spot. It's not pre-planned. It's not as a result of reward and punishment. And so this really gave rise to the idea of cognitive psychology and later on cognitive science, and that humans produce this unique behavior. And let's look beyond the rewards and punishment and see if we can find other mechanisms that are responsible for behavior. And so we started to look at other variables that produce behavior in humans. And we found lots of relationships between things, particularly when it came to language. And so cognitive science was essentially born at the same time as cognitive psychology. And this is a combination of cognitive psychology, philosophy, and computer science. And people who are interested in these types of problems are interested in how the mind represents information and reproduces it neurologically. And this is very applicable to computer science. This is essentially AI. You know, so how does the person work, and can we model that mathematically and make a computer work in the same way? And so the philosophers got involved, and they put forth some thought experiments and said, well, you know, that would really work, but, you know, what about this? Searle's Chinese Room? Searle's Chinese Room is essentially the idea that if you had a man in a room who spoke no Chinese, but yet had explicit instructions on Chinese characters and translation, could this man translate any language into Chinese? And if that were the case, and this person got good after some time, would you say that this person spoke Chinese or not? And so, of course, you know, you wouldn't say that that person spoke Chinese. You would say that that person essentially was in a room replicating the instructions to translate Chinese. And so this idea, this Searle's Chinese Room idea, is very important when it comes to artificial intelligence. We still don't say that a computer can actually understand the things that like a person can understand, the things that are being entered or reported. The computer is simply like Searle's Chinese Room, and it spits out instructions, or it spits out output according to these instructions. And so computer scientists and psychologists started working together on these problems, and then people started to get degrees in both fields. And this happened in the 70s and the 80s. It was very popular. Computer scientists work in psychology and psychologists work in computer science. And so you don't really need a degree in both fields. You can do research across the fields very easily. Excuse me. So one of the problems in engineering psychology, which is also called human factors, is who should control automation? So we do a lot of work in unmanned vehicles. So think of driverless cars. And driverless cars are really coming a long way. Here's an example of two different ones. And I hope my videos work. Yeah, so this is an Infiniti and this is a Toyota. And driverless cars, that's the direction that we're going. But along the way, we're starting to add features that once we refine those features, then we can add all the features in, and eventually the cars will become driverless. And so for us in psychology, there's quite a bit of work in this. We have to figure out when the car should have control and when the human should have control. And how does the car signal to the human that it's time to take control? And how does the human signal to the car that it is time for you to take control? And so let's take a quick look at two of these videos. Here's the Infiniti, and it's driving. It looks like it's driving to me on the test track in Florida that I'm familiar with. University of South Florida has a test track, but it might be driving somewhere else. But we'll take a look. It doesn't really matter. I'm going to turn the sound off because they just play some music. And I want to make a few comments on the video as we watch it. So you'll see, it's really amazing that the sensors aren't interrupted by the types of guardrails or pylons across the sides of the roads. The sensors are able to pick up the dotted line and the solid line very easily. And then as the car continues, you'll see that traffic slows down and the car is able to slow down in response. And so the automation in the Infiniti is very good. But of course, Infiniti produced this video. And so I'm sure they had more than one take. And there's a person in this car. You just can't see that person. He's blurred out. So here you'll see the traffic starts to slow down. The car slows down in response as a driver would. So it's very natural. and the driver accepts it as a natural response and sees the pylons on the side, knows that there's construction coming up. And so that's a really good, the human factors people did a really good job there. Toyota, this is not a professional video. This is actually a car salesman video, and he's taking his Toyota out and figuring out how the automated lane control works. So we're gonna skip ahead. He has a lot of music. He has a lot of words too. So we'll just skip ahead here. Now, the way that he uses it is very interesting. So he uses it a lot like cruise control. And if you drive and you use cruise control, you know that you have to set your speed, you turn it on, you set your speed for a minute or two, and then the car takes over. And so this person's idea of how this automated lane control works is similar. He thinks that he has to steer the car, and then the car will take over like cruise control and keep the car within the lane. But he's not as successful. He doesn't crash the car. But you'll see that the car does veer into the other lane of traffic. And it does also veer off of the road. And so it's really not clear if this is user error, so something that the driver is just really not familiar with the best way to use this automation, or if the automation just really isn't perfected yet. And I suspect it's a combination of both. So let's go on. Let's see. This is always tough. Oh, all right. Another area where psychology and computer science and mechanical engineering have really come together is in robotics that help people learn to walk after a stroke. So if a person has a stroke, the stroke can happen in any part of your brain. If it happens in your language centers, then your language is disrupted and you have to relearn how to talk. If it happens in your parietal cortex or some of your motor centers, then you can have trouble walking or moving. And that's what's happened to this unfortunate individual. And he has to relearn how to walk. Let me see if this will show in the, wasn't showing before in the PowerPoint, but we'll see if it does. And she's just gonna talk about this. But it's really fascinating. And so this is a huge contraption. And as, so they've pre-programmed walking into this robot, and they put the person in there, and then as the robot causes him to walk, his brain relearns those movements, and then the neurons, the right neurons, start to fire together again. And if you remember back to that portion of Introduction to Psychology, neurons that fire together, wire together. And so those patterns of synaptic connections reconnect. And eventually, after a lot of effort and a lot of time, he will be able to walk again. So they put him in this device and it has to hold up his weight. And here it is. It holds up his weight. It positions his body upright. And you can see here, it has a fairly natural gait movement. And this is all done mathematically. And so what they do is they have people in black suits, black leotards, and they connect sensors to all of your joints and different parts of your leg and your hip and so on. And then you walk different places and they take mathematical measurements. And essentially they apply some very advanced statistics to it so they can predict where you're going, you are going to go next. And they program that into the robot, into the walking mechanism. Take another look here. And here you can see, so it's a very natural movement, and that's based on a lot of what we know about psychology, how people walk, and how people perceive. And he's pretty red in the face, so this is taking a lot of effort on his part. Learning to walk again is no fun. There's one other part I wanted to show you. Oh, here it is. Yeah, and so you can see the back of this device as well. Here, this is really interesting. They have a feedback monitor where the person can watch and see how much work he is doing versus how much work the robot is doing and how his gait is coming along. And then this mirror is very important. And so we have things called mirror neurons, not having to do with the mirror, of course, but we have neurons that will mimic movement, and those are very important to wire things correctly. We also have perceptual neurons, sensory neurons, and by him watching himself in the mirror, then he's able to wire all this stuff together at once. And so you'll see that they encourage him to watch himself in the mirror because it helps things wire up a little bit faster. And they can change the speed and the tempo to what works for him. All right, enough about this. All right, and so someone submitted a question about artificial intelligence, and I thought that was a great question. I'm really glad that you submitted it. And so I pulled up a definition, just like you could anywhere. So computer systems are able to perform tasks that normally require human intelligence. So visual perception, speech recognition, decision-making, and translation. And so, a lot of AI really started in translation and language. And I like to say that it started with McClellan and Rummelhart's paper in 1981, and then their book in 1982. And they really wanted to solve a language problem. And this language problem was something called the word superiority effect. And this word superiority effect had been around for decades. And it took psychologists a really long time to figure out what was going on. And briefly, the word superiority effect is that it is easier to recognize and pronounce this word next than it is to recognize and pronounce this word zent. And that's because this is a word and this is not a word. And so a lot of the time in my videos or in my presentations, I like to show videos when the lecturer does a better job at explaining something than I do. So this is an example here. And so this person has done an excellent job. He's on YouTube. And here so he is.
This diagram.
So let me preface this a little bit. He's going to explain the interactive activation model. And these down here are input layers and these are output layers. We're gonna watch this whole video because he just does an excellent job, and then he talks about the word superiority effect.
It helps us to understand how the interactive activation model works. And what it shows is layers of units within a cognitive system. And at the lowest level, we have feature units. At the middle level, we have letter units. And at the top level, we have word units. And to see how these work together, let's suppose that a person is presented with a letter P. So the letter P consists of a vertical line segment and a kind of reverse C shape. And at the feature level, we have two feature units that represent those particular line segments. And these become activated, and they pass their activation on to units at the letter level. And we can see here that the units representing L, E, and P have become activated. So the vertical line feature unit activates both the L, the E, and the P.
And I'm going to stop him there, and then I'll jump ahead here. And so we know from some of the work of Huber and Weisel, when they were looking at how neurons fire and what makes different neurons fire, that neurons in our eyes, in our visual system, are sensitive to angles here. And so we know that these neurons exist. And so we know that something will fire when it sees a vertical line like this. And then within this middle section, these are called hidden units. And these hidden units, and we think that there could be thousands of them, help us to guess what the combinations of these perceptual parts represent. And these hidden units are weighted. And so we're more likely to see a P than we are perhaps a D. And they help us guess what we're looking at. So they're weighted and they are also stochastic. And so they are based on basically statistics. So let's move a little bit ahead. And this idea of this interactive activation model or parallel distributed processing is really what it is the key to artificial intelligence. If this model had never been discovered and proposed, artificial intelligence wouldn't exist today. And so McClelland and Brummelhart did us a tremendous service, even though they didn't investigate AI, they created it. And there, let's see, here's the word superiority effect. And this person gives a really nice demonstration.
First identified by Cattell in 1886, but was very convincingly demonstrated by Riker in 1969 and Wheeler in 1970. And it's sometimes called the Riker-Wheeler effect. The effect itself is the fact that when you show a person a letter in isolation and ask them to identify it, they are slower to respond than if you show them the letter in the context of a word. So let's see how that might actually look in an experimental situation. So a person on one particular trial might see a letter string like this, L-E-A-P, making up the word leap. And this would actually only be shown for a very brief moment of time before it's replaced by this visual mask. And then the person is asked to choose between two letters, which of these letters did you see previously? So that's one kind of trial. In a second kind of trial, the first screen would show not a letter string, but just a letter in isolation, followed then by a visual mask, and then the choice. What did you see on the first screen? And it's here that people are slower to respond than they were on the first kind of trial. And there is a third kind of trial that we have, which is where the first screen again presents a letter string, but now it makes up a non-word. And that's followed by the visual mask and the choice. And again, people are slower to respond in this condition than if that first screen is showing a genuine word.
And so there we have the word superiority effect, and we have some actual numbers that we can put to it.
So that is the...
So their work in the word superiority effect and this idea of the hidden nodes and interactive activation suggested that words have other attributes as well. So they have position, so there's rules of speech construction. They have frequency, so some words are chosen more frequently than other words. So think of carrot and carrot. There are things like homophones, so things that are pronounced the same. Carrot and carrot is another example, but dual and dual are pronounced the same, but they're spelled differently and they have different meanings. And then there are use attributes. And so these are ideas like a bank where you put money, or a bank like a river bank. So this brought forth the idea of logogens. And so this idea is that a word has attributes that specify how a word could be used. So you might think of hashtags, you know, now. So instead of rules, there could be invisible hashtags that connect these words. And so this idea of hashtags and weights and hidden nodes really gave computer scientists a lot to work with. And so this gave computer science something that they could start to build neural networks with. They could build learning and decision-making models, you know, finally some type of human process was made numeric enough that they could build a computer program on it. And so let's take a look at these two videos side by side for just a second.
Let's see back propagation in neural network with an example. This is a neural network. In this is the input layer, this is the hidden layer, and this is the output layer. Okay? And these two are the biases. Okay? Now, from input layer goes to the hidden layer. Then from this hidden layer, the output of hidden layer goes to output layer.
And that's really about all we need right now for this lecture. And these W's are weights. So weight one, weight two, weight three, weight four. And then let's take a look here.
So this diagram helps us to understand how the interactive activation model works.
And so essentially we have the same thing. We have an input layer here, perception. And then we have these hidden layers. And then we have these weights that make one choice more likely than another, and then our output layer.
From this, we'll get the output, actual output.
Okay. I have a couple more slides on interactive activation, but I think in the interest of time, I'm going to skip them because I think that I've made my point. Any questions? All right, I don't see any questions or hear any questions. So let's continue to the fun stuff. All right, so decades later, you know, this was back in the 80s, long, long time ago. So decades later, computer scientists have worked, and engineers, electrical engineers, mechanical engineers have worked really hard on these concepts, refined them, and made some very useful tools for us. And this one, I really liked. Let's see if it pops up here. All right, so this is InferKit. I really like this one because it also, it also tells you how it works in these docs. Here we go. So let's type in a preposition. And we'll generate text. And so this is very interesting. At the meeting, Eric said that his foundation has been making progress in local school districts as well as overseas. And so the AI didn't make any mistakes in this sentence. Everything is grammatically correct and semantically correct. Grammatically meaning there's no weird words in here that don't make sense, and semantically meaning that the meaning of the sentence makes sense. I can't thank the teachers and people of the area enough for supporting us and helping us to succeed. We've reached out to 4 schools, said Eric. And so that's very interesting. As well, they were able to pull up a quote. Let's press continue anyway and see if we can get the AI to make any mistakes. Aha, here's a mistake. When asked about the future, Eric and his family will be sharing some of the remaining $250,000 that has been raised for JDRF. And so here, that is a nonsensical sentence. And we have it again. So Slater said the foundation raised more than $3.6 million. And then we have another copyright. And so the AI wasn't smart enough to keep the copyright out of this. Earlier, I did one. And it had a few nonsensical words in there. And so this is really interesting, this text generator, and you can find this at interferekit.com. You can use it yourself. It's free to sign up. Okay, so what neural network is this? We're currently using Megatron 11B, the largest publicly available language model. It was created by Facebook and has 11 billion parameters. And so when you use Facebook, or your parents or your friends use Facebook, you may think that you're simply using a social network, which you are, but actually you are entering text into this Megatron 11B model. So think about that. So this model, the chat that they bring back up, is a neural network. So just like the interactive activation that we just saw, that's how this one works. But it predicts the words based on this big group of words that it has collected from Facebook. So let's go back to our presentation. Yeah, so I'm almost to the end of the presentation. I wanted to show a little bit more about robotics. I think the language part is very interesting, and the language part is very important because that's how AI started. But now people are still working on the language component. It is getting better. It's really fun to fool Google Assistant, and then sometimes it's really frustrating with to use Google Assistant. I'm sure you know, and Siri as well. And those are all issues with language processing and language understanding. I will tell you that if you have an accent, please start to use Google Voice, because just like Facebook, Google is starting to collect a corpus of word sounds. And so sometimes I have a Southern accent and I always use Google Voice. I want to have my accent represented in this corpus. It will make this corpus as a body of language. It will make this much easier for everyone to use. And so it's a benefit. And plus my conversations are never of anything important. So back to robotics, so we have language and then we have robotics. And robotics is really the combination of computer science, mechanical engineering, electrical engineering, and some other types of engineering, industrial engineering as well, and psychology. And there's a lot of psychology in robotics. Boston Dynamics, a huge company, was sprung off of MIT. That's Massachusetts Institute of Technologies. And they're in Waltham, Mass. And they initially started with a DARPA contract and a Navy contract, but a lot of their robots were initially made to carry packs for soldiers. And again, I'm gonna turn off the sound because it's not very important. And you can see one of these first, this is from 2012. And so these are some of their earlier models. And some of the things that they had to figure out is, not only how do we get these robots to not fall, because it would be horrible to be a soldier and be waiting for your pack somewhere and the robot has fallen 20 miles back and nobody knew about it. And so making a robot that can climb lots of different terrain, making a fast robot, very important. And so they modeled a lot of human and animal walking. This is modeled after a dog walking, and they did it in the same way. Somebody was all in black and then they put sensors on them. And for animals, for dogs, they just took lots of videos of dogs walking. For industrial robots that work alongside of people, you want to make sure that the robot isn't too scary. And so the robot can pick up delicate things. 10 pounds is not very hard for a robot. And you want the robot to mimic human movement. One of the more challenging things for a robot to do, of course, is to navigate an unstable or changing terrain with no sensory information, only motion information, and that's what's happening here. And again, a lot of what we know about psychology, about sensation and perception, and how people figure out how to do these things, have helped us convey that information and use it in robotic and computer models. In this case, again, you want a model, a robot who is going to persist. So if a task is interrupted, you want a robot that's not going to give up. And here's another robot that's able to pick up a glass, which is just amazing because glass is clear, has a very small reflective surface. And then at the same time, that robot can pick up a can, which is actually very delicate. And it looks like it has a hard surface, but it's not. want a robot who can recover from a fall and in a human way. So the robot doesn't look scary and scare the humans that might be around it. And again, so it recovers in an animal-like way. When things have four legs, we infer that they're animals, anthropometric. We infer a mental model or mental image that we already know. And here's an industrial robot. And some of the challenges with industrial robots is how to get the humans that work alongside them to accept them as coworkers, not interfere with their work, not be frightened of them. But yet we want these robots to be fully functional and be able to navigate any sort of work environment that they would encounter. Now, these robots are extremely useful. They can do things that humans can't. And they have a lot of really useful functionality. So again, you want the robot to be able to persist. And how would you do this in a natural way? That would not interrupt the robot's action or the human assistant action. And now here is the same robot, and you can see the same robot is a little bit slower to open the door. And then props the door open with its leg, just like a human might. And then finally, some of the challenges, the new challenges in robotics, have to do with human trust and the human's ability, of course, to work with the robot. And so manufacturers are starting to try and humanize robots a little bit more, give them emotion, give them fun actions like this, some gymnastics, allow the robot to fail occasionally. See how it jumped? It jumps those stairs just like a human would jump. And then this is the end of the video. I think this is one of their first robots pulling their car or their truck. All right, now my favorite video from Boston Dynamics. You may have already seen this. This video is really fascinating to me because robotics have come such a long way. And some of the movements in these robots are just really extraordinary, like being able to stand on one leg, and some of the ballet-like movements. And so there's an article. Let me share this article with you real quick. Spectrum IEEE. And you can Google this. If you were in my class, you would have a copy of this. But you can Google this, how Boston Dynamics taught its robots to dance. And so this is really fascinating. A really fascinating read. But let's take a look at the video. And for this, you need sound.
You broke my heart, 'cause I couldn't dance. You didn't even want me around. And now I'm back to let you know I can really shake them down. Don't you love me?
I'm especially impressed by this section right here. Where they had the robots do ballet moves, and they talk a little bit about that. Yeah, and they talk a little bit about that in that article, especially when they're on one leg. That's tremendously difficult for a robot to do. Not so hard for us to do because we have the perceptual mechanisms built in, our neurons working all the time, figuring this all out, but the robots don't have that advantage. And so modeling what a human does and how a human does it has really been the key to give robotics a start to figure out how to get the robot to do this. And in that article, they talk about how they use professional ballet dancers and taught the robots. All right, well, with that, I'm gonna stop sharing. And if you have questions for me, please let me know.